This meeting belongs to a series of math industry meetings. So up to now, we've had a few talks coming from academic people. And now we switch to real problem in industry with Salomon, who's originally a French company, well known for sports and leisure. I must say that I'm very happy to have them here because 2 years ago we had organized something about math and sports, and CNRS has a long tradition to be in touch with Salomon, and they said, we're not sure we're ready to come and present something. So I'm all the more happy that this time they've accepted to come, and we were looking forward to this wonderful talk.
Thank you. As he said during the presentation, so we switch from academic presentation to industrial presentation. So you will see that the presentation is not exactly the same format, but I think you can follow it. We have two presentations with Sébastien after and Liz and myself just now, and I will play the stupid guy. I will present you the most easy way to apply biomechanics in our world, in our project. And Liz and Sébastien will show you more complex subject. First of all, our mission is to develop new product, new concept. So we need to understand what happened in our different sports. As it's presented just before, we work mainly for Salomon, but not only. We are part of an international group. The name is Hammer Sports. And we develop sports shoes also for Wilson, for the tennis, and for a Canadian brand, Arc'teryx, for high mountaineering shoes. And in my easy, stupid example, I have one for Wilson, just to show you that sometimes we can create a nice concept with very simple things at the beginning. And of course, at the end, our job is to validate what we create. We are here to sell shoes, to make business, so we need to succeed to create something new, something different in the market. So as I said, I have two simple examples, where one for Wilson and one for Salomon. After Sébastien will present you a more complex one about try to model the trail running performance, especially in downhill. And after me, Liz will present you what we do in terms of finite element modelization. So first, for Wilson, if you follow this sport, in the last decade, you can see that the speed of the game increase a lot. And some players try to adapt himself by this type of training, but some other players change his technique. And I think that video is very interesting. Look at Gaël Monfils and see this and the next one. So you can see that even in hard court, some top players succeed to glide in a hard surface. It's completely crazy for us at the beginning of our project because you have very grippy midsole, very grippy shoes, and a very hard surface. So at the beginning of the project, we think that maybe that gliding in a hard surface can increase the performance of the players. And after a few months, maybe a few years, we succeed to develop these shoes with this picture just here. And our goal was to validate if with this type of shoes, with this type of technique, we succeed to increase the performance. So we built, Seb built a very nice protocol to do it. And maybe the most easy way to show you a result is with this video. In this video, you will see the same players with two different types of shoes, the glide shoes and the traditional one, in the same picture, in the same video. The two videos are synchronized when the ball enters into contact with the racket, and you see the difference when the players glide and not. I can relaunch it if you want. And at the end, when I say I'm a stupid guy, what do we measure? We measure only, we measure only a distance, a 2D distance between the center of gravity of these two tasks, and we measure the difference in between the glide shoes and the non-glide shoes. In a more scientific way, I'll show you the result. The result is we have a difference of displacement of half a meters and time of replacement better of 42% with the glide shoe compared to the traditional shoes. So at the end, we succeed to validate that gliding in hard court improves the performance of our players. The second subject is about trail running. Maybe that you know that trail running is not like road running. We run in mountains, and the techniques used by the athletes is completely different. And it's impossible for us, even if we have a nice lab in our building, it's impossible for us to test our shoes and our athletes in our labs. To reproduce a trail running technique in a lab, it's quite difficult. So one of our jobs is to be able to measure, to create some device or to measure our quantified parameters directly in the field. In this picture, what we want to show you is we try to measure the running technique, so how the athletes touch the ground with his foot directly in the field. So we put two synchronized accelerometers in the shoes in order to measure if the runners run rear foot or forefoot. So we have this type of graph with two accelerometer signals, synchronized accelerometer signals. For example, when the trail runners run rear foot, so with heel contact at the first time, we have the black line with the peak of the heel appears before the peak on the metatarsal area of the foot. So we are able to calculate the difference in terms of time between the peak apparition in between the heel and the metatars. We have the inverse signal when the runners run forefoot with the metatars attack on the ground. And here again, it's very simply to calculate the difference between two different time apparitions. Again, in a more scientific presentation, we are able to synchronize this time difference to the gold standard measurement technique of the running technique in a lab with a 2D camera, and we are able to say we are forefoot, midfoot, or rear foot. You see, sometimes it's easy. The next slide for me, but it's only a teaser, it's for the presentation of Seb. You will see with the presentations after that we try also to modelize the performance in trail running to see how our athletes evolve and to try to help our athletes in our 2020 day in order to help us to adapt the training effect. And it could be more complex.
Okay, so I'm going to present a very quick overview of what we do with finite element modeling in footwear at Salomon. So first of all, what is finite element modeling? In short, because I only have a few minutes, it's a modeling technique that simulates deformations and stresses of objects when they're subjected to different loading cases. So we use it as a prediction tool. Why do we use finite element modeling in footwear? In the R&D team, it's to better understand the human body and the shoe, and so to guide conception. And it helps the company to reduce development time and cost, to improve product quality, and also to find new solutions and innovate. And so what type of simulations do we perform? We do simulations of material behavior. It's the basis in finite element modeling. You have to understand how the materials behave before you make a concept. We do simulations of footwear mechanical tests, and then simulations of biomechanical tests where you can study the human body movement. So I'll show you details about these types of simulations. So to start simulating material behavior, we have to understand how the material behaves. So you have to perform a bunch of mechanical tests that help you to decide what type of material we have. So in footwear, it's a lot of foam materials. They're viscoelastic, they lose energy. So the characterization of this type of materials is quite complex, and we have to find the right model to be able to simulate a different test. So one of the tests that we simulate is a shock test. So here you see an axisymmetrical type of test where you have a mass falling onto a foam slab. So it's a free fall, and it's supposed to reproduce the impacts that you can see in running. And obviously, when you do finite element simulation, like any type of simulation, you have to validate your model. So you have to compare the experimental results and the simulated results. So we do have a shock test in real, and we can compare if we modeled our material correctly. The next type of simulation is a simulation of mechanical tests that we actually do on the shoe. So here you can see the shape of a shoe. It's called the last in footwear, and it's a rigid shape. And in the same way as you saw before, you have a mass falling onto the sole. So it's just the heel part of the sole that you see here. And basically it helps you to understand the rebound that the mass has once it impacts the shoe. And in the same way, we validate that model. So this time, we validate the models that we use. So here you have a foam model and also rubber for the outsole. And you compare the curves and see if you can validate your model. What you can do after that is, once you've validated your model, you can choose the type of materials you want to use to optimize the rebound that you want to have. And then the more complicated type of simulation is a gait simulation. So what you can see here is a heel attack of a full leg. You don't see the upper leg, but this leg has the skeleton, muscles, tendons, ligaments, skin. So we had to have the good material models for all these parts of the leg. And what you can see on the right is a comparison between the motion of this leg and the recorded movement that you had in the lab. So you can see it's quite good. And once you have that, in the same way that we did for the shock test, you can actually compare your materials and geometries and see if it's optimized. So that's it for me.
Any questions in the audience?
My question was about the first part of the presentation. I was asking how does the shoes can impact the acceleration measurement on the shoes how the type of shoes can impact the acceleration measurement, and how did you take in account to the rear foot or forefoot pattern?
Several parts of the shoes can affect the accelerometer and the accelerometer signal, and it depends where we put the accelerometer also. And for example, in one of our studies, we showed that what we call the drop of the midsole, the drop, it's the difference of thickness in between the heel and the meta, so the slope in the shoes, modify the running technique. More you decrease the drop, more you induce a forefoot technique with a runner. So the shoes can modify the technique, for sure. Another example is for the cushioning, the absorption of energy of the shoes. With the example of Liz, if we modify the material, if we modify the geometry of the shoes, you can change the energy absorption of the shoes and the dynamism of the shoes. So you can see it on an accelerometer put in the tibia of the runners, for example. So yes, we have interaction in between the shoes and the running technique and in different parameters. And we try to select the right biomechanical or mechanical parameters linked to our consumer needs. For example, if we speak about road running shoes, the most important thing for our consumer is the cushioning of the shoes, but it's not the case for trail running, for example. For trail running, it could be the grip, the stability, etc. So we try to adapt our measurement to the consumer needs.
It was only for one subject, for one specific pupil, or
it depends of the project. If we speak about our athletes, we adapt our shoes to each athlete. For example, the shoes that we have in the picture, it's a project with Kylian Jornet. We develop the shoes specifically for Kylian, but of course we work also for our global business. So for traditional consumer, traditional runners, and we try to have a representative group in our experimental protocol to create these shoes to this group, to develop the shoes.
Okay, thank you very much.
I just want to add a piece of question to what you were speaking of cushioning. That is, there's also the issue of hopping or being able to. Do you model in your finite elements anything reacting to the cushion part of the shoe or the ability to hop and react on the ground?
Yeah, we do model, but what you saw was only the heel part of the shoe in the shock test. So that's one test that gives us information about cushioning. So in this case, it's energy return, really. That's what we try to model. So it's something we try to optimize for the type of running we're looking at. And then the leg is used also for another part of cushioning, which is more linked to tibial accelerations. And it's also something we look at in order to optimize cushioning. Yeah.
Thank you. thank you. For the last biomechanical test you show, what do you impose or what do you drive? The muscle, or it's, I don't really understand.
Well, you do have initial conditions that that you find when someone's running, so velocity of the center of mass, velocity of different segments, and then for the way it's driven, it's driven with muscle force. So it's something we measure in the lab, and we try to recalculate to have the right muscle force to do the type of motion that we want to do in time. Yeah.
Impose the muscle activities in time.
Yeah, there's different ways to drive a model. You can do that, you can impose displacement. It depends what you're looking at, but mm-hmm. This one is with muscle forces. Yeah.
Any other question? No, so we move to the next speaker who's going. Thank you.